Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Kevin Smith, who will introduce Stan and Roy.
Hey! Hey! Thank you. I'm just gonna stand here for a second while we intro and stuff before we get going. There's an intro and then another intro. This is a cool event, ladies and gentlemen. I never thought I'd live so long as to be standing in a museum talking about comic books. But that's the world we live in now. Now, everybody in this room here, of course, naturally must be a Marvel fan. Maybe there's a few distinguished competitor fans out there as well. But we're in this room because we love these stories. We love the idea of a simple story about the whole world running away from the worst thing that ever happened and a couple people in very colorful costumes running right toward it, man. That's what always brings us together. Now, fandom has multiple levels to it. Some people are just happy to read comics and be into them and like, oh, that was a great adventure. I have a friend named Jason Muse. He's a dude who will constantly talk about comic books, but not aspiratively, like one day I want to work in them. He's the guy that's just like, who could beat who, the Hulk or the Thing? And you're like, what do you mean the Hulk? You mean the Hulk? He can't pronounce it right. So that's a level of fandom that's absolutely valid. We've all been there. But then there becomes a point where you read so many of these stories that you find yourself going, well, what about me? What's the difference between the persons who make these stories and maybe me having ideas for my stories? And today's event is it's that story. It's the story of a little boy, or really a little boy at heart, but who was an adult by the time he got his journey started, who was a big fan, as big a fan as the people in this room probably. And the difference is he took his fandom to the next level and kept going and took it beyond simply like, I love what they do, and then added spokes to the great wheel of Marvel. If you're very lucky, you get to meet the people that you look up to. And if you're extremely lucky, they don't disappoint you. They're stellar human beings. This guy was brought into this industry by somebody he looked up to, and we got them both here on the stage tonight. So as we sit here and talk about 75 years of Marvel, the thick-ass book that you saw that could kill a cat, and will when I get home. Remember, there was a time, don't feel bad for me, but when I was young, if you wanted to know information about these characters, these stories, you had to have the comics. This is before the graphic novels or anything like that. But Marvel did publish something called the Handbook to the Marvel Universe, which was one of my favorite books because it didn't have an adventure in it. It was just an encyclopedia, an overview of every character, their powers, their abilities, some of their adventures. In that spirit, when the internet was invented and suddenly you can find any piece of information in the tip of your fingers just by tapping. In fact, you can go beyond information to look up. You're like, you can enter, I want to see someone dressed like Vision having sex with someone dressed like Ultron, and you'll find it, man. So the internet changed everything. But this book, the book that we're talking about today, is the internet for Marvel in book form. This is the book that I dreamed about as a child. Something that massive that would legitimize my passion. Something that, like, as you told friends, like, no, this guy, he's cool. Even though he's wearing a very colorful outfit and carrying a shield, I swear, he's cool. This book absolutely answers the question for those outside this room, because everyone in this room would know the answer to this question. Are comic books legitimate? Oh my God, fuck yes. And so here we are talking about them here at the Hammer, and we're going to talk to two people who dug the trench, ladies and gentlemen. Like, when we talk about these characters and now the movies that we see them in, and as fans of the books, we watch them become movies and our hearts soar as we see these concepts that were once two-dimensional become three-dimensional. We're going to be sitting here talking to two people who put some of those characters into the world. Can you imagine? Could you imagine sitting down and talking to, like, Arthur Conan Doyle or some other author? it's the only one I could really pull. Isn't that weird? Today, we're going to do that. Today, we're going to sit here and talk to him. And first, I want to introduce, I'm going to bring them both out, of course, but first, I want to introduce the little boy without whom we don't have this adventure today. He's grown up considerably. But that little fan from Missouri who loved comic books enough to get himself to New York to start working in the comic book industry and go on to create some of this company's biggest characters, man. Give it up for the absolute legend, the original comics fanboy, Roy Thomas.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that nice introduction.
Second chair.
Mm-hmm.
And they said I wouldn't draw, right?
This is the man you have to thank when we're all sitting there 2 minutes before midnight or whenever they open Avengers Age of Ultron. Ultron baby daddy right there. The baby daddy of almost everybody else is right backstage, man. And you could say a million things about him. He's a modern day Mark Twain as far as I'm concerned. I could go on, list all his achievements, but I'll just go right straight to the top. This man was in Mallrats, ladies and gentlemen. Without whom we don't have the Marvel Universe we know, man. This was a guy who at one point said, you know, I'm not going to do this anymore. And his wife said to him, you know what? Write the one story you want to write. Write it any way you want, man. That way, if you quit after this job, doesn't matter. At least you did it the way you wanted to do it. And that birthed the Marvel Universe. And yesterday, he was married. He just celebrated an anniversary, married to that very same woman, without whom you wouldn't have the Marvel Universe as we know it. He's been married to her for 67 years yesterday. Isn't that amazing? Give it up for Stan Lee!
Gee, you guys sure are long-winded. Thank you, culture lovers. I thought you guys would never stop talking. I'm sitting out there waiting.
Is this when we sign the books?
This is it. Bring out the table and start signing.
Can we sign the books while we're talking?
You got better things to do? Ladies and gentlemen, these cats right here have been friends for a long, long time, but there was a point where they didn't know each other. And I want to take you back to that moment. We're going to chit-chat for a little while. Then, never mind me, we're going to find out what you guys want to ask. But I'll just give you a little brief overview history as we talk to them, and then we'll turn to you. We know the Marvel story, and we'll get to that, but we got to start with you because that's where the book emanates from. You're a kid in Missouri. What's your first comic book?
I don't know. Probably a Superman or Batman. I was about 4 years old. My mother says I saw these colorful things on the stands and said I want one. And she got them for me, and she read them to me. You know, I thought Batman and Robin were Badman and Robber for years because they wore these masks, you know, things like that. Eventually,
Did
I learned
I hear to... somebody say Batman and Robin?
And then I... Yes. Sorry, Stan.
What's your language?
And then I got around to the... Then I got around to the Human Torch and Submariner and Captain America. But I just loved comic books. And other people quit when they were 10, 12 years old. You know, they discover girls. I never discovered girls, you know. But... I just kept reading them. You know, if the superheroes left me for a few years, I'd read Archie, I read Mad, I read Pogo, I'd read anything in comics form along with other things.
What was it like at that point when you're reading books? Like when I was growing up, at a certain point in high school, you had to abandon comic books because real men or women don't read comic books. And that's obviously untrue. But in comic books, in high school, I did put comic books aside because there was no community for it. It's one or two people. You'd have to tap your foot under a bathroom stall to find the comic book people like in the school and stuff. What was it like when you were a kid? And you mentioned like other kids fell away from it. What kept you into it?
I'll show you why I'm such a good interview guest. It was awful.
This is for you.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to step on your line. I thought he'd never get around to me, that's all. I can't hear what he says anyway, because this muffles your voice.
Absolutely.
When you talk to me, put the mic down. They don't have to hear. I'll hear you.
Done and done. So awkward getting chastised by Stan Lee.
Get used to it. It happens from time to time over the years.
He does it on set to me all the time. Okay, so what was it like? What was it like being a comic book fan?
I didn't think people in high school knew I was a comics fan because I wasn't bringing him to school or anything like this, but... Everybody knew about it, evidently, you know. But nobody else that I knew except one guy, you know, read comic books, and I traded a few with him, and that's about it. I just kind of, you know, I read them on my own, but I didn't think about them for a few years, and I figured they were part of my past, but, it's just something I'd look at now and then. And then all of a sudden, when I'm in college, you know, or in high school and college, they suddenly bring back the... close your ears, Stan, in case you accidentally hear something. They brought back The Flash and Green Lantern, and they started the Justice League. I'm sorry. And then one day, when I was about the time I graduated from college, I walked into this store, and I see this Fantastic Four number one. Yep, about time, right, finally? And I recognized the Jack Kirby art because he had been doing all those monsters, none of which I ever bought. I never bought Fin Fang Foom or any of that stuff. But I knew them, and I love this. And so I thought, well, this looks good. This has got, hey, it's a new version of the Human Torch, and here's this monster hero, and this guy looks like Plastic Man. So
and didn't it say the world's greatest comic book on
I don't
the
think
cover?
You said it on issue one. I think you waited an issue
was
or two.
Was
that
on issue one?
I think you modestly waited one or two issues before you put that on there. I think you waited a whole two issues before you put that on. So I bought two copies because I said this might be worth something. And it was, you know, that was the greatest investment I ever made. When the price went up to 50 cents, I sold that second copy.
I ran to the office and I said, somebody bought two copies. We're in.
You can hear better than you say you can, you know. But that was, and from that time on, I recognized right away that as much as I love those DC characters, and I had a good relationship with Julie Schwartz, the editor of the DC comics like that, but I recognized real quickly that the drawing was more exciting and the writing was so much better and aimed
could have said the writing
like
first and then gotten to the
well,
drawing.
You know, you see the pictures first and then you get inside and you read it and you discover this isn't just another comic. It's got these people are more real. They don't like each other. The Justice League, they never did that. They never slugged each other and called each other.
It was
easy
for me to write. I didn't like most people.
So anyway, that's basically it. But enough about me. Let's talk about Stan.
So while this is going on, and we'll jump back
you're
to you.
You're talking to me. Put the damn mic down. I can't make it. See, when he talks into the mic, it sounds to me like...
I'll try this
that's
on the side of my
that's
mouth.
That's what he said. I'll translate.
While this is going on, while he's reading the books that you wrote, man, let's take one step back. You've told the story a zillion times. Tell the story.
What did he just say?
He wants you to tell the story of how you created the Fantastic Four. Maybe?
The Jones story, yes.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
You can go now, Kevin.
How much time do we have?
We got enough time for you to tell that story. It's adorable.
Well, I had been in the business for a million years, and I was ready to quit because I didn't like the stuff we were publishing. I didn't like the stories I was writing because my boss, the publisher, said to me, Stan, just give me a lot of action, a lot of fight scenes. That's all the readers want. And I said, well, how about concentrating on story? Forget the story. Put a lot of fight scenes on every page. Well, I wanted to get paid, so I did it. But after a while, I got sick of it. And I said to my wife, I'm going to quit. And she said to me the wisest words since the Ten Commandments. She said, why don't you write one the way you want to write it? You're going to quit anyway, so if he fires you, who cares? But get it out of your system. And that's when we did what?
The Fantastic Four.
The Fantastic Four. See, I want to make sure he's paying attention. The man tends to fall asleep when I talk. We have that relationship. And so that's how the Fantastic Four was born. And I didn't get fired because the book sold well. You mentioned you bought two copies. That helped a lot. And then the publisher came to me after he saw the sales figures. And he said, let's do a lot more books like that. So that had us on a roll, and we did. I don't remember the order, the Hulk, the X-Men, and all of them. And we were having a lot of fun. Can I go home now?
Let me ask you this question.
When do we sign those things?
That will be soon.
We have like 1,000 books inside to sign, and he's sitting here like nothing's going on.
I didn't write the book, so I don't have to sign it.
So he doesn't care. He goes when we start signing, he goes home.
Yeah, goodbye, everybody.
Or back to the hockey game or wherever he's.
Let me ask. You sound like my mother. Let me ask you this, Stan, and this is reaching very far back, but when you came up with a character, this is just a writer question. Did you see something in your head, or do you just pass it to the artist and say you come up with it?
No, I really pretty much passed it to the artist. I knew what I wanted the characters to be like. I'll give you one example with Spider-Man.
Did you see that? He left a gap for the applause.
Don't interrupt.
My bad. Sorry, sir.
The last cheer has it. I wanted Spider-Man, Peter Parker, to be just an ordinary, nerdy kind of guy. I didn't want him to look like a hero, not overly good-looking. Women didn't fall for him. Just a guy, you know, like everybody in this audience. And me.
You see what it feels like?
Don't step on my lines.
My bad. Sorry, sir.
And I figured that's what I wanted. So I gave it to Jack Kirby to do. And I said, Jack, I told him when I told you, just an ordinary guy, kind of a schlub. And that's it. Well, Jack is so used to doing these great superheroes. He did a few pages based on the outline I gave him. And Peter Parker looked like Captain America. So I said, forget it, Jack. And I looked around. And there was Steve Ditko, who couldn't draw a handsome man if his life depended on it. I'm only kidding. But I thought Steve Ditko's style would be better. So I gave it to Steve, and he really drew the right kind of a Peter Parker. And that's how it happened. If Jack didn't care, because he was doing the Fantastic Four and the Hulk and the X-Men and whatever else he was doing. So we had Jack on this side, and we had Steve Ditko on this side, and nothing could stop us. Thank you.
Now, in reader world, you're about in your 20s. You go to New York not to work for Marvel first, but to work for DC. Is that correct?
Yeah, assistant editor.
You keep using that name. You have to.
Yeah, for Superman.
It's like trying to tell the Bible story without the devil, Stan. You need
Wait,
to say
I
DC.
I got to tell you something about DC. Then he'll answer. We used to be called Atlas, and then we changed our name to Marvel. Because I felt, damn it, we've got these great books, and we need a name that's got some sex appeal, Marvel. Because you can say things like, make mine Marvel, welcome to the Marvel age of comics, and so forth. Well, when we changed our name to Marvel, DC was called National. And they tended to copy us a little bit, so somebody there decided they would change their name. So I want to give you an example of the thinking that went on here. We called ourselves Marvel because it was a name you could really play with. And they went from National to DC. And that was a little story I thought I'd tell you. And I'm kind of sorry I mentioned it. Go on, Roy.
I'm still stuck on the sex appeal of Make Mine Marvel. It suddenly puts that 67 years married into perspective.
I'll sing you later the Marvel marching song.
Oh, I remember that. Okay, so you don't go to work for him right away. First, you go to work for DC.
Assistant editor of the Superman. He was in Superman. He was in Lois Lane and Jimmy Olsen. I think the dog had his own comic book at that time. But after 2 weeks, I was really miserable. I didn't like the editor, and I was going to stick it out because. But I wanted to meet Stan Lee because he was writing the great comics. So, of course, being in New York, the same city, I wrote him a letter.
And I was adorable, too.
And I wanted to take him out for a drink and, you know, just say hello because we had exchanged maybe one or two letters. And
Who
he said,
pay for that drink?
Well, you wouldn't meet me. You said, I don't socialize with, you know, peons, you know, basically. But you said, but we have a little writer's test, you know. Why don't you come up and... You know, so I thought, well, so I sneak off during my lunch hour one day from Marvel. It's about a 10-minute walk, and I go up. I think, I'm going to meet Stan Lee, and he's going to give me the writer's test. Well, out comes this secretary, you know, Flo Steinberg. She gives me the test. Where's Stan? Well, he's busy, you know. So I go off. So I finish the test overnight. I bring it back. I'm going to take it back the next day. And this is a Friday, and I said, I'm going to meet Stan Lee. I'm going to give him the test. I go in. Well, this time the production manager, Saul Brodsky, comes out. Here it is. Oh, where's Stan? Oh, he's busy. You know? So I go away. I figure, well, that's the end of that. You know. And then about an hour or two later, I get a call while I'm editing a Supergirl story. And they say, Stan would like to have you come see on lunch hour or something. And about 10 minutes after we met, he may deny this, but it's pretty important to me, he just looks out the window onto Madison Avenue, where he usually looked just looking down to see how many girls were walking on the street, you know. And he'd been married a while already by this time. And he said, well, what do we have to do to hire you away from National? He still called it National. And I said, just offer me a job. I said, I hate it there, you know. So that was it. So I went back to D.C. and I told my editor, you know, I've quit. I'm going to work for Stan Lee at Marvel. I'm sorry, it just didn't work out. But I said, I'll work for you as long as you want me to till you find an assistant. I won't leave you in the lurch, you know. And the guy said, Weisinger said, get out. You're a spy for Stan Lee. I don't know. I don't know what. So I went back, and that weekend I wrote a whole issue of Millie the Model for Stan. So it worked out pretty well for me. And it saved my life, you know, really. I could still be in that covey, you know, getting Pavlovian sweats every time the editor rang my bell. Stan was a little better boss than that.
Now, this is something that's kind of relevant to this audience, too, and we skipped over it. In order to get the job at DC, which eventually got you to Stan and Marvel, You were writing for Alter Egos at the time, Alter Ego, the fan mag?
What we call a fanzine. Somebody else started it, but we would write articles. Of course, it was mostly about DC because, DC Comics, because they had all those characters earlier. And when we started it, there wasn't a Fantastic Four yet. But as soon as Fantastic Four came in, we were broadening to discuss that too.
But essentially, was it like what they do now on the internet, where a fan will just get into a forum and start talking about, oh, I love this issue, this is what I thought about it?
Well, we always tried to do history too. Of course, I was so talented, you know, I used to draw cartoons, just wretched cartoons and everything, and it's sort of trying to be a Mad Magazine kind of thing. And I wrote articles about the old comics and about the new comics, and I never wrote anything about Marvel too much, but but we just kept busy, and somehow that's what came to the attention of the DC people and got me I got to New York, and once I got to New York, I got to Marvel. I would never have gone up writing Stan a letter saying, can I come to New York and work for you, Stan? Because Stan was writing all the books, and I figured he wants to go on writing all those books. He's writing 8 or 10 comics a month. I said, he probably wants to do that forever. You know, it turned out he didn't.
Really?
Is that lucky for me.
Is at a certain point where you're like, I don't want to write a single another script. Let me hire somebody else to do it. Like, I've done it. You went through an insane, probably one of the most public and insane periods of prolificacy in all of the arts when you think about it. Think about the amount of characters that you generated. Just sitting in a room going, oh, Spider-Man. And then suddenly there was a Spider-Man. Did you get to a point where you're like, I'm done writing. Somebody else can do this. Is that what it was? Is that when
No.
No? What happened? What was it?
I liked writing them. And I liked working with the artists and with Roy and the other editors. And why would I want to stop? I had to stop after a while. They made me the publisher. They got rid of the publisher. I became the publisher. And then it was my job to travel around and do whatever publishers do. I can't even remember. And I never really went back to writing all the books again. I just took the blame for things after that. But that was a pretty dull answer, but I don't really remember what the question
was.
No,
it was it was predicated on a dull question.
And
I'm sorry.
What's he saying?
I
may look like the most perfect physical specimen you have ever seen, but I just don't hear well. And this guy has a voice that's on a range that's totally out of the way. And then he talks into this thing. So Roy, what did he say?
It's been so long ago, I've forgotten.
All right, it couldn't have been important.
I was talking about how handsome you were and stuff. You were talking about going out there into the world and stopping writing and being the publisher. That's where you first came up on my radar. The first Stan Lee I ever knew was not Stan Lee writing scripts for a comic book. It was Stan's soapbox. It was your very definitive voice talking about how important and fun all of this was beyond the stories.
Had all the soapboxes put into a booklet and you could buy it? I don't know if it's still for sale, but if it is, I don't know if I get a royalty. If I do, buy a lot of them. If I don't, forget it.
I'm sorry to tell you this, Chan. It was for charity. You gave the rights to charity. I'm sorry
for
about
charity?
It. Yeah, I know charity begins
That's
at home.
That's very unlike me.
I know. All right. They talked you into it.
But anyway, I love doing those soapboxes because it gave me a chance to talk to the reader, you know, kid around with the reader and get the reader to know who we were. I'd write about Roy. I'd write about John Buscema. I'd write about Saul Brodsky. I'd write about all the guys in the office. And I think the guys enjoyed it. They weren't anonymous anymore. I enjoyed it, and the readers seemed to like it. And we felt we were like a little family. We were all enjoying the same thing. And the competition, they were just selling stories.
Right. But that was so ahead of its time. Like, what you guys were doing in the soapbox, what you were doing by being like, hey, this guy, he's this guy. Hey, this person, they're this person. You were sitting there creating your own stable of people, doing what, like, the internet does on a regular basis, shining a light on people that might not get the chance, man. Like, it was way ahead of its time. That draws you into it as well, I would imagine, right? Like, just reading.
Oh, I was an original MMMS member. I bought that record.
It stands for the Merry Marvel Marching Society.
Is that
I
what
want
it was?
You to know.
I forget.
Yeah.
But,
I'll sing you the song later.
And, I bought all the comics, and there was a little merchandise. I think just about the time I got to New York, they were starting out with the T-shirts, You know, they had a comic convention, and I wore one of the first Fantastic Four and X-Men T-shirts different days and so forth. And
was
we
that
were just
like,
thrilled
that
to
must
have that.
Been so amazing, like somebody walking up and seeing that on your chest. Like, now it's commonplace. Yeah. You could see a shirt for anything.
It's just a shame it was so late. It should have been when I was 6 years old. The problem is I was now 24. And I'm still wearing that X-Men T-shirt. You know, that's no good.
He threw around a bunch of famous names. Were you there at the same time? Like, did you see him interacting with the other legends? Did you ever see him in a room with
Death? And I was awed because, you know, Stan Lee, now, I knew Stan Lee's name since My Friend Irma comics. He used to write My Friend Irma, and his name was real big. And I loved My Friend Irma, this dumb blonde comic based on a radio show. And
did other books besides superheroes. We had these funny books about pretty girls, Millie the model, My Friend Irma, Nellie the nurse. We had romance. I got to tell you a funny thing about the romance books. All the romance stories were supposed to be confessions. That is, they were confessions that the girl was writing. This is what happened to me. Now, I wrote most of them. And I was used to putting my name on everything I wrote. But how could I put my name on a story that was supposed to be written by a girl confessing something? And to show you how incredibly brilliant I am, I came up with this idea. I put my name on the front page, but I wrote, as told to Stan Lee. As if this girl caught me at an emotional moment and confided the whole thing. What was the question?
I don't think there was one.
Is that the letter?
You sing the Marvel song yet?
We'll get there. Is that the letter you wrote to Stan? A confessional letter about, like, I never believed it would happen to me, but.
No, I didn't do that.
So which, the first comic you said you wrote was which one?
Well, I told a lie, actually. It was called, I said Millie the Model, but it actually wasn't. Millie the Model was still then popular enough. She was actually in two comic books. And this one was called Modeling with Millie. So I started off on the B title, you know, and I had to work my way up to Millie the Model, you know.
What was the first superhero gig you got?
Oh, that was wonderful. Gene Colan had drawn his first Iron Man story. And Stan gave me this beautiful artwork by this guy. He was drawing under the name Adam Austin then, but it was this wonderful artist, Gene Colan. And I wrote this story. I stayed late and I in the office writing it, and I was so proud of it. I brought it in, and Stan said, well, we got to change this and this. It ended up, it was about 50% him and 50% me, and it had no credits at all. It says, everybody in the office worked on this one. You know? I think my name is in there with the secretary and the colorist and several other people. But then I was lucky. I got to write. The next thing was a couple of I got to do dialogue for a couple of Steve Ditko, Doctor Strange stories. Stan just had to get rid of a few things here and there, so he would try me off, and then he would.
He was like my human waste paper basket.
Pretty close. And the proudest moment I finally ever had after I was doing books like Sergeant Fury and his Howling Commandos was Stan would still be changing stuff a lot, you know, rewriting, and I certainly needed it. And the production manager was going crazy because Stan would wait to do this until it was all inked and lettered. You know, it's a lot harder to change inked, lettered stuff. You know, you got to white it out and all this. So finally, the production manager complained so much that one day finally Stan said to him and to me, he says, from now on, Roy, any comic story you write, show me the first page and show me the last page. And if they're okay, I'll figure everything else in between is okay. And after that time, we had a great relationship for the next 30 or 40 years.
I can't really answer that because I couldn't make out most of it, but I'll bet it was a very funny story.
It was brilliant, brilliant.
Now, we know a lot of the characters that Stan created, but give everyone here a list of the characters per Marvel that you're personally responsible for.
Well, of course, somebody else drew all of them, I tried to avoid creating characters.
Why?
Because I knew I wouldn't own them. Stan didn't own Spider-Man. I didn't own, you know, Martin Goodman owned everything. So I knew I was going on board a pirate ship, and I don't mean Stan, publisher, when I went to work. So I said, I don't want to create any more than I have to in terms of heroes because I'll get mad sometime if they ever make a movie or a TV show out of them. I knew myself. So I avoided it. But you can't avoid making up some heroes and a lot of villains. So luckily, one of the ones I made up was Ultron, this robot, and bless their hearts, they're going to put him in a movie. And then I made up the Vision. He was sort of based on an old Jack Kirby character, but he was also new because he was an ant. Stan came to me one day and he said, We need a new Avenger. And I always loved it because I was always trying to bring in Thor and Iron Man. He had kicked them out of the... Even Captain America got kicked out of the Avengers for a couple years. And I'm left with all these... I got Hawkeye. I got the Black Widow. I got a couple others. I said, you know, I can't do this book with these guys. They're no fun.
Hey, didn't you do Conan?
Well, eventually.
You were like a Conan specialist, weren't you?
Yeah, well, I had to get something that was sort of, you know, that you didn't know anything about.
I knew nothing about it.
And that way you'd leave me alone, see? So... I was, you know, but by that time you taught me so much, you know, that I was on my own there. But
I created a Frankenstein.
But anyway, so all that happened was that Stan came to me one day and he says, we need a new Avenger. I said, let's bring back Captain America and Thor and Iron Man. He says, no. He says, let's make up a new one. He says, I was going to bring in the old Vision, who was an old character who has lived in another dimension. And Stan said, nah, that guy's no good. He says, you know, I want you to do an android. The next Avenger has to be an android. He never told me why. Is it to investigate the human condition? I don't know. Just said, I guess he figured I'd know what to do. He says, he's got to be an android. He says, does he have to be, have any particular name? So he said, no, just an android. So I made up an android called the Vision. You know, I swiped the name and altered the costume, and we both got what we wanted. He got his android, and I got my Vision. And Netflix is going to start a series about a character I invented, Iron Fist, and everything. I'm pleased with that. I made up Iron Fist with the great artist Gil Kane. Anybody know his work? And we designed this wonderful character, and I wrote exactly, and we did together exactly one Iron Fist story. In my whole life, I wrote one Iron Fist story, but it was the first one.
Right.
You know, and I never touched the character again in those last 40 years. That was it.
You dropped the mic after the first one? Look at that headpiece. It'll never get better than this. Bang.
It was. I'm not going to go into great detail, but it was the equivalent of a one-night stand.
That sounds marvelous. As Stan mentioned, you were and will always be the Conan guy. I mean, Conan existed. What was the guy who created him?
Robert E. Howard.
Yes.
Who happily killed himself 4 years before I was born, so he couldn't get mad about what I did with his character. He just his estate just collected the money, and they were happy.
He killed himself. I think it was probably after reading your script.
Probably. If he hadn't, he would have.
No.
But it was the readers who told us. We knew that stuff. I'd bought some of the books, but I never read any of them. I bought them for the covers by Frank Frazetta, but I never read them.
But I think you absolutely had a lot to do with making the character popular. Mm. You wrote so many Conans.
I wrote a lot.
And people loved those stories. Mm. I couldn't stand them, but I was not the
right.
Public.
Stan always says, I don't understand this sword and sorcery stuff. Says, you ever get an issue of Conan you really think is right, that I should read that's good, drop it, you know, this was a great, amazing thing. Stan's going to read a Marvel comic that he didn't write, you know? So he says, drop the copy. It was a printed copy without the cover that they would send us early. Drop the copy in my inbox, and I'll read it. So I waited till issue number 4, which is Tower of the Elephant, my favorite Robert E. Howard story, which I had adapted with the brilliant young British artist Barry Smith, later Barry Windsor Smith. So I said, well, this is a wonderful story because it's Robert E. Howard, and I had fun, and Barry did a wonderful job drawing it. I put it in his inbox. Stan picks it up. Said, "What? He takes it in. He brings it back out a minute later. Plops it down on my desk. Says, well, I guess it's okay. It's not my thing. And that's the only comment I ever had from Stan until now.
Well, he didn't really have a superpower. He was just strong, you know.
He could lift Arnold Schwarzenegger. That was all he could do.
Yeah, and he was Arnold Schwarzenegger. So how much Arnold Schwarzenegger can you take?
You know Arnold Schwarzenegger is in those early Conan comics because they'd have the Conan comics, and then the ad would be a Mr. America type of ad with a photograph of Arnold Schwarzenegger as a young man in 1973 or 74. We never dreamed the two of them would ever get together.
The most amazing thing about you is you can remember years, like 1973 or 4. How do you do? I can't remember one year from another.
Well, I don't have as many as you do, you know.
Nobody does.
I'll get there.
Favorite character of the entire spectrum of your career? Your favorite character you've created?
Spider-Man. I say that because I'm expected to say that. Everybody expects to hear that. I love them all, though.
Right.
It's like asking a mother who's your favorite child. I love them all.
You?
I don't like the characters I created so much. I like the Thing. The Thing.
The Thing.
You remember him? The Thing.
Oh, I love
Big,
the
lumpy,
Thing.
Lumpy, orange, yeah. social problems.
It's clobbering time.
Since the moment I saw him, he became my favorite character, and all the other characters that I made up or anybody else ever made up, you know, never meant anything to me as much as The Thing.
And the book has a passage about how The Thing was so successful that they were like, do something like The Thing, and that's where Hulk came from as well, correct?
Didn't do quite as well, though, The Hulk, did it? The Hulk, the first time around, it only lasted 6 issues. It didn't quite make a big hit the first time. Why do you think that is?
No, it needed the television series to really make it. That TV series was great.
I could sit here and do this all night, but let's open it up to these guys, because you guys probably have a zillion questions, and we'll get some really...
And a zillion books to sign.
And we got books to sign. These good guys want to get to the books.
To sign,
so. How are we going to do it? Hands up or something like that? There you go. Hands up. Somebody's got a microphone. They'll run a microphone up to you. There's one right there. Go ahead. We'll start right here with this gentleman in the corner. How are you, sir?
Fine, thank you. Fantastic Four versus Superman. Who wins?
Fantastic Four.
Millie the Model versus Superman. Who wins?
Millie the Model. Superman, the one thing about him that I really admired, because it was so realistic, such great writing. Whenever he took off his glasses, people said, Superman, what happened to Clark Kent?
Isn't that amazing? Decades later, he's still kicking him in the balls.
Hey, tell me something. Does it give you a great feeling of power to be the one to select the person who's questioning?
Yes.
You know, you sit here, not you. You over there.
Yeah.
You over there. Boy, that
They're
really
like my Silver Surfers. I'm like Galactus. I'm going to eat them. The microphone went somewhere. There it is.
Hi, 2 quick questions. I'm sorry. Is it true that Robert E. Howard's Conan stories are now in the public domain because he's been dead more than 60 years? And a second question about the old pulpy Marvel comics, like the, you know, the Confessions and the Doctors and all the romance stuff. Is there a possibility that that may be made into some kind of TV series? Is that like the old Marvel stuff that's not superhero oriented?
I would love it, but. Is he allowed to ask 2 questions? What are the rules here? You may have violated some incredible rule here. You may be in big trouble. What was the first question?
I thought. Is Conan public domain now? Do you know?
I don't
Roy?
Know about the particular stories, but they would have trademarked the name, and I'm not going to help anybody swipe. You know, Conan. They're doing all right with him, and you know, just let him go. Let him go. Make up your own character.
When are you going to give me another role like you did in? That movie of yours. I try to be nice to
you know
him.
What I
invite
like? You
him
know
on panels. Nothing.
You know what I like about you? That character you created. What was his name again? Oh, yeah, Spider something. Stan and I just recently worked together in another movie. For the first time in 20 years, we worked together in Mallrats, and then recently we shot a movie called Yoga Hosers, and he says the name of the movie. It was pretty awesome. He's the one that says it out loud. But having him on set was an absolute delight because, like, usually on set, you're a director, and everyone, like, looks at you like, hey, he's in charge. And then he comes over, he goes, what do you want, idiot? And you're like, all right. Next, here we go. Microphone, grab one of those cats somewhere up there. Grab a lady. I know there must be ladies out there.
Hi, Sandley. What is your most memorable cameo in all of the movies?
Most memorable cameo in all the Marvel movies.
Oh, I love every one of them. Each one seems to be better and more fulfilling than the last. They have a dramatic quality that just sets them apart. But I cannot tell you. I'm not allowed to tell you my favorite one because it's the last one I made in the Avengers movie, which didn't come out yet. But you must see the Avengers because when you see that cameo, it's Oscar time for that. It gives me a chance to show my acting chops, you know? So don't miss the Avengers.
I'm so glad somebody's doing something for that little independent movie. Getting the word out. Let's go to this side. There are the 2 hands with Captain America. He's very excited.
Stan, I just want to say thank you for the Marvel Universe, for the characters that I grew up on, that my children grew up on, and that people will grow up on forever, long after you're gone.
Amen. You're welcome.
The question I have is, will the Marvel Universe ever be brought back together? I know that Spider-Man belongs to Sony and X-Men to Fox. Is there ever a plan to kind of bring them all back to Marvel, back home?
Is there ever a chance of
how the characters are spread across a bunch of different movies.
Take the mic away from you.
My bad.
Talk like a person.
The characters, Sony has Spider-Man, Fox has Fantastic Four. Will they ever all come back?
Oh, that's a very good question, and it's something that Marvel is very concerned about. It's very difficult to get them all together because these characters are so successful and make so much money that the studios that have the rights to any of them don't want to let them go. So that's something that all the lawyers and all the production companies have to work out. Whether they'll ever get it worked out, I don't know. But it is a shame. It is a shame that Marvel can't distribute every one of them, because then we could put them all together, and you'd have you could put the Avengers, the Guardians of the Galaxy, and every other group together in a movie that would make $100 trillion.
Isn't that the next movie, Avengers 3, The Lawyers? You know,
the real winners.
Oh, by the way, I do have a cameo in a new show coming out, a TV show called Agent Carter, I think. Watch for the fourth one. I think my cameo is in the fourth episode. They ought to be ashamed of themselves that they didn't give me three others before that, but what the hell. But it's kind of a good cameo.
This is the one thing that I could say, though, about the companies, the characters being split up over a bunch of different companies. If Disney and Marvel had Spider-Man, it'd be all top tier. The fact that they had to go like, okay, let's see what we could do with Guardians of the Galaxy. Suddenly they create something that's like nobody ever saw that one coming. Like, you expect them to make a great Spider-Man movie, or at least a watchable one, no matter who has the character. But nobody expected anything of the Guardians of the Galaxy except for the brass Marvel, who were like, I think this will be the one. So I'm actually kind of happy that they are split apart, because you see them trying. Like, there's going to be an Inhumans movie. That never would have happened if they had Spider-Man. So,
well,
but
they're doing that to make you happy, because you said it makes you happy.
It is.
Your happiness is very important to the studios. I want to tell you. They talk to me about that all the time. I meet an executive at a studio. Hi, how are you? Hi, how are you? Is Kevin happy?
I want you to come tuck me in bed at night and say those positive things. Everyone cares what you think.
I can understand what he's saying.
Let's go. Here we go. We were on this side. We go to this side. There's a lady right there. Hoodie.
Thank you. Okay. So, obviously, we all go see Marvel movies to see Stan's cameo, but when will Roy have a cameo?
That's a very good question. When will I have a cameo? When he lets me.
He's having a cameo right now. What's the matter with you?
Yeah, I got in touch through Stan with Joss Whedon, who's, of course, doing the Avengers movies and so forth, and he didn't offer me a cameo. He says there's something about me in that movie, but it's not a cameo, but we'll see how it goes. But I'm just happy, you know. My job in Avengers 2 is to cash the small check that they will send me for Ultron and the Vision, and I'm quite happy. I got no complaint with Marvel or with the movies, don't worry. But thank you very much, and I'd like to do it too. I'm not as big a ham as Stan is, but I'm okay on my own. But thank you. We can play father and son here, you know.
Way up top, here it comes.
Stan, unbelievable. Kevin, big fan, you know, since you started. I don't know how you know about places like New Kensington, PA, or Monroeville, but, you know, it's where I'm from, but it's such a little tiny place, and Stan... just to say anything to you is a privilege and an honor. I want to know when you, Kevin, and Stan are going to get together in a sense of, like, your movies are amazing, the comedy, the funny. I want to see a superhero movie that you make. No. One that you guys, maybe he has a character that he's in his back pocket, you know?
No.
How about that?
They want those movies to make money, so... So they let Stan be involved, and me, they're like, you could watch. And when it comes to those, nobody loves a comic book movie more than me. I'm not even being facetious or overly pronouncing this. When I say the fact that we're living in an age where I could see a Marvel movie, the fact that I'm going to be able to see an Ant-Man movie any minute, the fact that, like, you know, they're making Justice League movies, Avengers movies, that makes me excited. I've always been that person. Even when I went and made my movies, I talked about other people's movies and characters I love. But that doesn't mean you necessarily want to make them. Those movies are far too hard. It takes talent to make those. I like making movies where people turn other people into walruses and shit. So... But I'm from now until the end of time, I'll be waving the flag for every one of these movies, but no interest in making them.
Well, we'll have one that you can wave a flag for, and it'll be your movie, because I'm going to tell you a secret. I haven't told this to Kevin yet, but you know his movie, Mallrats? Yeah. I want him to do a sequel, starring me, of course. And what we're going to do, I haven't told him yet, we're going to give one of the Mallrats a superpower. So we're going to work that out, and all of a sudden, it'll be right up there with Spider-Man and so forth, and you better show your gratitude financially.
The really funny thing is, I bet you, like, if I was to go pitch a Mallrats 2, I would have to bring the most successful member of the cast back, and it would be you. I'd be like, this guy's in movies that make hundreds of millions of dollars.
The thing I don't understand, you're such a big comic book fan, a superhero fan, right? And you do movies, when the hell are you going to do a superhero movie? And I'll help you with it.
Thank you. No.
Only if I star in it, of course.
Man-Thing 2.
Man-Thing 2. Oh, my Lord. I can't wait till they make a Man-Thing movie. All right, where are we? This side? Were we this side? Yes. And pick anybody. I see the dude waving his hand right there. Hulk shirt.
Big fan of all you three. Big fan. For Mr. Thomas, what made you... I love the Invaders, and I wanted to know what made you start that in the mid-70s? You know, was it a risk to kind of do stories that were back in the timely era, and what passion led you to do it?
Well, I'd written all the Invaders, for those of you who don't know, which is 93%, I think I can tell from here, is The Invaders was the World War II time adventures of Captain America, the Human Torch, and Submariner, and it had to do with my interest in history and my desire to avoid writing anything else except that and Conan. I loved the Marvel Universe. I mean, I was a fan of the Marvel Universe, you know, from when before the phrase existed, and I helped pull it together with a little thing called the Kree-Skrull War, which brought a couple of things. And that was my passion. I loved to take the staying stand in with Jack Kirby and Ditko and, you know, help with the continuity a little bit and so forth. But after about, 9 years or so, when I stepped down as editor-in-chief, I wanted something different. I just wanted to do Conan, who was off in his own universe. I wouldn't let anybody, not even Stan, could write Conan, you know, only me. And there was a Red Sonja comic a character I had co-created, and... So I said, well, what can I do that'll use some of the good heroes so they can be popular, but I won't have to have a meet Spider-Man, and I won't have to meet the Hulk, and I won't have to get together with other writers to know what they're going to do next month. So I said, well, I'll take Captain America and the Human Torch and the Submariner, but I'll put them back in World War II when they were created, and that way, you know, it's my own little world. It was not the most commercial idea I ever had, but I had more fun with it than I did with... it's probably my favorite... As much as I love the Avengers, it's probably my favorite Marvel superhero book to write ever. And the one I would, if anybody would say, what Marvel book you want to do and write, I'd say, I want to do the Invaders for about the next 30 or 40 years.
Oh, my Lord. How sweet, man.
We might even get up to 1943 eventually.
But isn't it nice to know, like, there's a dude who stands up in the middle of nowhere and he's just like, oh, man, I love
the Invaders. He remembers
the Invaders. Yes. That's tremendous. Okay, over on this side. Sure, right up top. Two hands in the air.
I just wanted to say it's a great honor to be speaking with all three of you. My favorite Marvel character is Deadpool. And besides...
Deadpool. You never heard of that
Deadpool.
One.
Deadpool. You might not remember it. But besides the teasers, are there any concrete plans to create a movie that is accurate on his history and storyline coming up.
Something I was going to say accurate. Yes, but until you said accurate. And
exactly.
Then they're making a movie from right now, from what I understand. I just saw something online yesterday about Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah, it was the teaser, but then...
Well, there was that teaser thing, but they're actually moving forward with a Deadpool movie and Ryan Reynolds.
I know they hired him as Deadpool, but I wasn't sure if they are going to create the movie. Okay, you just said yes, but...
They're doing the movie. I don't know if it's going to be any good. I can't predict that. I could barely make a decent movie myself, let alone predict how others will do. But they're making it. That's that much I know. You guys don't know anything about Deadpool, right? No. You want to get to the last one. Okay.
We have 100 books to sign.
We got to get to a signing.
We got a lot more than that.
So we're looking for... We're looking for the last question. You got two hands there. You look very excited. So you sure this is a finale question? You're feeling it? All right. Nothing about these
cats.
Which
is stronger, the Thing or the Hulk, you know?
Yes. We'll get there.
Every generation kind of has something that defines the way they see comics. And I won't use the DC word, I promise. I don't want to offend. sorry. But the one thing that is really big right now, for example, is Image. And the reason I bring that up is because you have a lot of creators at Image who also work at Marvel and who alternate back on projects because they feel that kind of getting their own creative desires out brings the best in their superhero work. So you have a She-Hulk comic that's about her just really being a lawyer. You have Hawkeye about rooftop barbecues and helping his dog. You know, it's things like that. And so my question is, what do you think about... writers and artists and creators kind of getting that out so they can bring something new and fresh to superhero books like the ones you work on now?
It's directed to you.
The pros, I would think. So both of you. Do you want to go first, Roy? Did you follow?
Yeah. I have an opinion because, I don't read those comic books, so I don't really know. But I wouldn't be interested in seeing Hawkeye, do a barbecue and so forth. That's just getting a lot down. A little of it, yeah. But when you spend a whole issue or standing around doing something like that, I understand. I can see why you do it. I can see why somebody would like it. I myself wouldn't like it. I want to see an explosion and a few things like that.
What
but
you wouldn't do? I missed the key point of this.
Have Hawkeye... at a barbecue for a whole issue. I'll explain it to you later. It's not yeah.
That's Avengers 3.
A lot of explaining.
Yeah.
It probably didn't even get close to the answer, did it?
I hope not.
Go ahead. I see.
Well, ask Stan. He's working for about 10 different companies besides Marvel now. Do you feel like working at other places and on other projects that are not Marvel, then can you bring something fresh if you do something with Marvel?
Oh, absolutely. We have a company. I'm still with Marvel, but I'm lucky. I'm allowed to do other stuff. So I have a company called POW Entertainment, POW. I'm sure you've all figured out by now.
Prisoner of War, right?
That stands for Purveyors of Wonder. And we're doing a movie now with a Chinese hero called The Annihilator. And we're doing a movie in India called Chakra. And we have some American things. We're doing a television series in England that'll be here soon. And a number of other projects, so we keep busy. And the nice thing is I don't have to write complete scripts anymore. I just have to come up with ideas for television shows or movies. Then we get other people to write them, and I get the credit, of course.
And how is this different from 1965? That's what I want.
I think I did a little more writing in 55. But so anyway, that's what I'm doing, and it's a lot of fun, and I feel like I'm back in the 50s and the 60s, but I'm working now for movies and television rather than for comics. I can't really do comics because my eyesight has gotten bad and I can't read them anymore. So it which I really miss. Even this great book that Roy just finished, what's the name of it? The Big Book.
Oh, yeah, right.
The TASCHEN book.
75 years of Marvel, from the golden age to the silver screen.
I look at the pictures, and all that small type drives me crazy, so I've got a big magnifying glass at home.
But you already know everything that's in it. Probably.
Oh, I have no memory. I read these things. Wow, did I do that? Wow, did Kirby do that?
You told me.
Was Roy
you did.
Really there at that time? I don't remember.
You told
anything.
Me you did it. You told me. I don't know. I just know what he told me when I came in the door.
I always tell the truth.
The book, aside from being heavy as hell, is packed with as much information as you could possibly want about the Marvel Universe, the creation of it, the birth of it, the growth of it, where it is today. But there was something that I love. Good writing just blows and pops off the page. And there was something you wrote about back then, in the beginning of Timely, the artists would, writers and artists, would use different names, pen names, because they were like, well, this is fine. I'll use this name for the comic books, but I'm going to save my name for the great work that's coming that I'll do. And none of them realized the great work they were doing was right there in the moment. Thank God Stan Lieber became Stan Lieber.
That happened to me. Yeah, I had a real name years ago. Stanley Martin Lieber, a real legitimate name. And in the beginning, I was so ashamed of writing comics because nobody had any respect for comics that I changed my name to Stan Lee just so that nobody would know. Later on, when the comics got a little more respectable, I was stuck with the name Stan Lee, and I decided to keep it. What the hell? When I do autographs, it goes faster.
And people like me, when I got in the field, if somebody had tried to tell me, you know, you can't have a credit or you have to come up with a fake name, I'd have wanted to go for their throat, you know, because my whole thing was just wanting to be in comics, and I wanted my name on the comics and so forth. So it was a generational. By that time, I had respect for the comics. But I admit it, I never thought that the general public was going to have, because, you know, the girls I went out with, the other people I met at parties, you know, they find out you do comics. They weren't that terribly, once in a while.
Yeah, but you were younger. By the time you got into comics, they were a little more respectable.
Not much.
When I knew comics, I'd tell you what would happen. I'd be at a party somewhere years ago, and somebody would say, hi, what do you do? And I knew what was coming, so I'd say, oh, I'm a writer, and I'd start to walk away. Guy would follow me, and he'd say, what do you write? Well, I still kept trying. I'd say, it's adventure stories, and I'd walk further. The guy would follow me. For what? I had to say comic books. The guy would turn on his heel and run away like I was contagious. But now I go to a party, and so I hear somebody say, excuse me, President Obama, I see Stan Lee just walked in. It's changed a lot. I think we can go now and thank them for being a great audience.
And ladies and gentlemen, I can't thank you enough for coming out, seeing two legends sit down, talk about that which we love most in life, our mythology that they created. The book is put out by TASCHEN. Save your pennies and get it. If you're a comic book fan of any sort, this is a must-have in your house. You put it on a coffee table. Shit, it is a coffee table. give it up for two legends without whom you have no childhood, Stan Lee and Roy Thomas.